All right, welcome back to lecture number 8, which is the last lecture in this series, Introduction to Data Analysis with R. Now, the thing is, there's so much to learn and only so little time to teach. So what I want to do today in this lecture, instead of aiming to teach you everything, just give you a couple of pointers on where to look further if you're stuck, and also if you're not stuck and just curious and want to investigate new things. So yeah, because I can't teach you everything there is to learn about R and programming and data analysis, I want to try and get you into the mindset of solving problems using R. And if you are there, nothing can really stop you, right? So let's jump into our studio. And the first thing I want to do is, because it's December by now when I'm recording this, so I want to make this a little more festive. There is this Christmas themed, our studio theme. And okay, well, the blinking cursor is maybe a bit too much. There is the same theme without the blinking cursor. All right, that's better. So now we are ready for Christmas season with our festive studio theme, which actually looks quite good. So the first thing I want to cover today is ANOVA, because I get asked about that a lot by especially people working with biological data, biologists, microbiologists, and the likes. Even though I myself don't use it a lot, because I'm working with different kinds of data mostly. However, let's quickly look at an example on when and how we use ANOVA. So I want to load the, let me put this up here and make this a separate section for today. Let's call it setup. So what we usually do is, of course, load the tidyverse. And I also want to load the Palmer penguins. Just as a little example dataset that you've seen before, so you don't need to think too hard about it. And I don't need to think too hard about it. So we got our penguins. And let's create a little plot where we have on the x-axis, we have the species of penguin. Species, yes. And just some of these, like one of these numeric variables on the y-axis. Let's go with the bill lengths. And let's create a box plot first. Oh, penguin is not found. Yes, that's because I forgot a P. And just to make this a bit more clear, let's also add the original data points on top, but make them very transparent. Oh, it's maybe a bit too transparent. And let me also run this script that runs before every chapter, before every lecture, so that our plots have the same theme, or this theme, theme minimal. Yeah, I quite like this one. All right, so we got our species separated, and on the y-axis we have the bill lengths that we find in these species. And now, a common question you have when you have multiple groups is there a difference between those groups? Now, what we could do is just run a bunch of t-tests, right? We could run a bunch of t-tests for Adelai versus Chinstrap. We could then run a t-test for Chinstrap versus Gentoo, and the last t-test for Adelai versus Gentoo as well. And then what we would have to do is correct these p-values from our multiple testing, because otherwise we would be lying to ourselves. Now, of course, this loses lots of power because we're having to correct our p-values. Oh, and I notice now that we are plotting the box plot and the points, this point here is duplicated because first it's in the points, the jitter points, but it's an outlier in the box plot, and outliers are plotted separately. So let's turn the outlier color to not assigned. And yeah, only do this if you actually are plotting the points, otherwise you're just hiding outliers for no reason. But now we're not double plotting the points. All right, where was I? I was talking about multiple comparisons. And so another way of going about this is running this ANOVA first. ANOVA stands for analysis of variance. So we are basically trying to figure out where the variance in our response variable, which would be the bill length in this case, comes from. And how it is spaced out over our predictors, our groups. And ANOVA can then tell us, okay, is there a difference in the groups? And if this is the case, what we can do is run a post hoc test. Post hoc, so after the fact in Latin, if you want to sound fancy. So we run a post hoc test on this ANOVA result, which will then tell us which of these groups is actually different, or which of these comparisons are statistically significant. And there's multiple options of types of post hoc tests, but before we do that, let's actually run the ANOVA first. So I want to use the function AOV for this, which stands for analysis of variance. Let me also open up the and yeah, ANOVA is also just a type of model. Let me open up the help page here. And the first thing it wants is a formula. So we want to fit the bill lengths, or we want to analyze the bill lengths in millimeters dependent on the species. And the data for this comes from the penguins data set. And now it says bill lengths in millimeters not found because I keep messing up THs. All right, we got our model. It tells us a bunch of things, but given that I want to show you so many things today, I'm not going to go into the detail. Firstly, we want to save this to a variable, and then we can use some functions on this to get more insights. For example, the summary function, not to be confused with the summarize function from dplyr. Summary is just the base R function that can give you a summary of any object. And there, if you so please, you also get one of these p-values. So definitely, there's definitely a difference in these groups. And optically, of course, we already see that there is a difference between Adelie and the rest. Maybe even between Gentoo and Chinstrap, but this is harder to spot. So they might be too similar. But Adelie is definitely different than the rest. So, but the p-value we get from ANOVA does not tell us anything about where and which group this difference is. It just tells us that amongst these groups there's definitely a difference. It doesn't tell us where, so don't use this p-value to say that this is now the p-value for a difference between, for example, Adelie and Chinstrap. No, this is the overall p-value for the ANOVA. Another way of getting information from this model object is of course the broom package, which I use quite a lot. So the broom package, let me do this in a new line. I don't want to open the help page in full screen. That happens when you are pressing too many keyboard shortcuts. So I want to show the normal result here, and then I want to show the summary, and then I want to show the tidy function from the broom package called with our ANOVA fit. Let's run one of these post hoc tests. The first and easiest to explain one would be to say we want to make all the comparisons that are possible. So the comparisons are listed in the beginning. We want to compare every group with each other. And this is done by the 2key method, 2keyHSD. Which stands for honest significant differences. So Tukey gets an ANOVA model, ANOVA fit. I just noticed it might be confusing. There is AOV for analysis of variance, but there's also ANOVA. ANOVA can be run after you ran a different model. For example, you run a linear model and then you run ANOVA and then you end up with the same result as AOV. So up here we used AOV for analysis of variance, not the ANOVA function. So 2QHSD, we are calling it with our fit, and then we get a result, and we get for the difference between chinstrap and Adelie, we get a tiny p-value, of course. We also get a tiny p-value for Gentoo Adelie, and let's actually pump this through Broom's tidy function, so it looks a bit nicer, and we are seeing everything. Yes. So this contrast thing is which group was compared to which other group. Just the name of the group and then a minus symbol. And then the p-value for this comparison. So all p-values are really, really tiny, and because we are not plotting enough significant digits, it just ends up as zero. It's probably 1 to the power of, or 10 to the power of minus something very large. But what happens if, and this will happen quite a bit in a biological setting, where we have some control group. So we have this control group, and we are comparing each other measurement or each other group to this control group. Say, for example, in this case, Adelie would have been our control group, where we say we added nothing of our substance we're testing or something, and then we have different substances we are testing. We would compare then chinstrap versus Adelie and Gentoo versus Adelie, but we would not compare chinstrap and Gentoo amongst each other. So this is what is happening in Dunnett's method. It's called Dunnett. Unfortunately, as opposed to Tukey, where we have a method in base R, Dunnett's method, there's no function in base R. So we need an extra package for this. And I was a bit hesitant to bring this out because, well, if you bring in a new package, of course, it brings in a bunch of more stuff. And right now we're only using a tiny, tiny portion of it. But I want to talk about at the multcomp package. So you can install it with install packages, multcomp. And multcomp, I believe, stands for multiple comparisons, where we can just, whenever we are comparing a bunch of groups, this has a bunch of helpful methods. And the way we are doing Dunnett's test with this, I will show you now. However, there's one important note. If I now load the multcomp package, weird things will happen. We get this message that the following object is masked from package dplyr, select. And this is a problem because I'm using the tidyverse a lot, and the select function is pretty important in the tidyverse. And because we are loading the multcomp package last, it brings its own package which also has a select function. This select function now overrides, if I type select, you see, we are getting the select function from the mask package, which is not the select function I usually want when I'm working with the tidyverse. And because this is the case, this will break a bunch of things. So now what I want to do instead is move the multcomp package in the first place, so it's loaded first, and then the tidyverse functions, actually just put the tidyverse down here, so we make sure all the tidyverse functions, if some other package has a function with the same name, or the tidyverse functions overrided. I'm more comfortable with it like this. Now rerunning this won't help us, because we are still getting the select function from the mask package. And this is because the tidyverse was already loaded, so it's not being loaded again. So in order to make sure this new order of things it's actually applied, we need to restart our R session. So session, restart R. And this, of course, loses all our plots, all our code, our variables here. Oh, it's nice and Christmas here down here. Okay. But what we can do is go up here and say run all chunks above, and we are back to normal. Okay, we have now the malt compact loaded, which means we can use the function glht. Let's open up the help page here, which stands for General Linear Hypotheses. And in here we pass it a model, so we want our, what did I call it? Our ANOVA fit. Our ANOVA fit. And secondly, a Lin FCT, which if you open up the help page, it's a bit, well, I think it's a bit convolutely written, but Lin FC is the specification of the linear hypothesis to be tested. Linear functions can either be specified by a matrix of coefficients, by a symbolic description of one of the linear hypotheses, or with objects returned by the function MCP. And we are going to use this MCP because then we don't need to specify everything by hand. So down here, somewhere writes how we are using the function MCP. But I don't like the way the help page is written. So I basically found this by Googling things. So we're using MCP in here. And what MCP does is the annoying thing is if you open up the help page, it's just the same help page. MCP doesn't have its own help page. But what we give it first is the name of our grouping variable, which is species. So and then we tell it how we want these species to be treated when it comes to multiple comparisons. We could, by the way, do the two key test in here as well. This would also give us a two key test. And we could do tidy the same thing, and we would end up with the same thing actually, except it puts a space here. But apart from that, it's the same. But MCP and GLHT is a bit more powerful. We can also do Dunnett in here. Now you might ask, you probably will ask, now it compared both things to Adelaide, which is good, which is what I wanted in the beginning. But how did it know that we wanted to compare to Adelaide? And the answer is factors. Penguins. Adelaide here is a factor, and the first element of the factor is ordered such that Adelaide is the first level in our factor. So if we wanted to change this, say we wanted chinstrap or gentoo, let's say chinstrap, say we wanted chinstrap to be our base level, what we have to do first is take our penguins. Let's do it somewhere else, yeah. And then we mutate. We say species is equal to FCT re. Yeah, re-level. So generalization of re-level allows you to move any number of levels to any location. So what we want to do is move the, like in the species factor, we want to move the Adelaide level to the front. And moving to the front is the default. Well, never mind. Adelaide is we don't want to move Adelaide. Adelaide was already the first level. Let's use Gentoo. And let's save this in the penguins variable. And now if I run this fit again, now we are comparing everything to Gentoo. All right, this worked. We are getting the p values we need. We are getting the models. But the next question is, how do we now plot these? People often or like to put these little brackets on top of these plots, which connect two groups, and then they have the p value on top, Or instead of the p-value, they have a number of stars indicating the significance level. So let's do that now. Take this here. And for this, I want to talk about ggplot extensions. And this is a great site to look at, where it's actually officially part of the ggplot tidyverse website. We get this gallery of extensions, and these are a bunch of packages which work well with ggplot or help us to construct ggplots or extend ggplot in one way or another. So it's a bunch of options there. I want to just pick a couple today and show you, just so you know that there's more out there, and also to show you something new. So the first thing I want to show is, I believe, ggsignif. And this is designed to add these significance things. However, by default, it does its own comparisons. If you look at the function geomSignif, which we get from the package, it has a method argument. Let me check. Method or our test argument, what test it run, and by default it runs a Wilcoxon test. And we have already ran our test. We already have some values. We did run ANOVA. Oh, one thing which I find a bit confusing, the ggsignif package states and talks about ANOVA, but it's not using ANOVA internally. It's using a different test. So this might be a bit confusing, just to mention this. We will use it in a different way, and by default it's not using ANOVA, even though it's talking about ANOVA in its statement of need. Right. But it's a very handy thing to have around. So let's use this one here. So I already installed it. And what I want to do is use ggsignif, geomSignif, and to use it manually, what we tell it is the comparisons we want to make. And this is a list of two element vectors with the comparisons, for example, then two. And don't worry, we won't be creating these by hand. We will use R to do this. I just want to show you how this works. So this is the comparison that we're setting. Oh, and now it did a comparison, actually. However, if I don't want to use this comparison, I can manually set the annotations. So if I type hello here, we get hello between these two groups. So it's very handy to just annotate our groups. And we could now manually put in our stars here, for example, or our p-values. But we already have some p-values, so let's use those. So I want to let's use Dunner's test and pretend we are comparing everything to Gentoo, because why not? I have this test here, and what I want to do is save this to a tibble. And I want to do another thing. Notice how in here in this list, where we specify the comparisons to do, we have a list. And every element is a two-element vector, where the first element is the first group and the second element is the second element to compare the first group to. And in our Dunner's test tibble, we have this contrast column, which is the first group, then some space and a minus sign, and then we have the second group. So we can use this using the mutate function. Let's create a new column. Actually, no, let's modify this column. Let's modify this column using the function string split. And I want to split at space and minus space. Let's look at what happened here. Now, contrast is a list column where every element is a two element vector with the first and second element. So let's let me actually control click this, show you. This is what every element looks like, and this is exactly what we need for the geomSignif function. So let's go here. Actually, let me do this down here so I can explain it once again in the script later on. So in here, we are now saying dunnet contrast. And what are we using as the label? Dunnet, let's go adjust a p-value. Right, we notice two things. Firstly, it's all plotted on the same line, which I don't know if there's an automatic fix for this, but we can also set the y position. Let's do it manually for now. Let's set the first one at 60 and the second one at 65. Oh, this is looking good actually, yeah. And now notice that we get these really large numbers. We could use the format function and change the number of digits we want to display. Or we do what people often do, is we indicate a significant result using stars. And the convention to do this, let's create a function to convert a p-value to a number of stars. Let's go with some p-value. And then I'm using the function caseWhen. So this is like a number of if this, then that. Let's open it up here, the help page. So we say, if the p-value is less than or equal 0.001, and then the tilde symbol, we want to return, I believe, 3 stars, which I guess people call like very, very significant. If it's less than or equal 0.01, we return 2 stars. If it is less than or equal 0.05, we return 1 star. And if nothing of these things happened, we compare it just to true, which is always true, of course. And we just return NS for not significant. And now in our mutate call here, we can add our stars. To the p-values, and now instead of stars, I didn't run the function here, and something's wrong. Object p not found. Okay, apparently I didn't execute the whole function. And now instead of the p-values here, we can use the stars. And now we have our annotated plot next to the package ggsignif. There's another ggplot extension called ggpopr, which has a bunch of extensions as well. And some of these also automatically create these types of plots. However, I still think there's value in creating some of these things manually, which means we have more control over it. And all these extensions, because they usually just return regular ggplots, you can still use your previous knowledge to then expand this plot as a baseline. Speaking of expanding plots, I want to show you the patchwork package, which I believe I have already installed. It's also mentioned on the ggplot extensions side. If we load it, library patchwork, let me actually just put this up here. It gives us the ability to take plots and combine them. So I'm not showing the full power today, but let's say we save this plot to a variable. We got our plot. And let's add a second plot. Here we go. Oh, and did I forget to rerun this here? So our plot looks differently now. Yes, okay. And this should also look differently. All right, let's save this second plot, plt2, to a variable as well. And now instead of displaying it straight away, let's take the first plot and put it next to plot 2. And this ability comes from the patchwork package. So we can specify using this syntax here that we want plots next to each other, for example. We can use the division to let's add the plot again. So this means plot 1 next to plot 2 over plot 2. I believe if we use parentheses, we can control further how this looks like. Yeah, and this is super powerful for putting plots next to each other. Notice also that it's so clever, it takes the legend and puts it to the side. So if we have, say we have plot 2 multiple times, or multiple plots which use the same legend, I believe there is a way of combining this legend into one using, I believe, layout. Now let me check in the patchwork package. Ah, plot layout. So we can look at the help page here. We are adding this to the whole thing. So and in there, I believe we can say guides collect. Which means it collects the legends and all the guides and other things into one, which is super, super handy. So if you ever need to create a bunch of plots that are very related, make sure to check out the patchwork package. All right, next up we have ggfortify. Which I won't demonstrate, but just want to mention here. Why not demonstrate it? Now, ggfortify comes with one main function, which is the autoplot function. And autoplot, and actually autoplot is already in ggplot, but ggfortify enhances this with more options. So if we have certain functions that return things like, for example, an overfit, they can also bring with them their own way of being plotted. So they can tell autoplot, all right, this is the way I want to be plotted when I'm being called. So let's see if an overfit has its own autoplot version. It does. Now, I'm not sure if this comes from ggfortify, or is already built into the ANOVA model and ggplot by itself. But ggfortify just brings more autoplot functions, and I want to use this segue to talk about autoplot. So autoplot is very good for very quick visualizations where we have a model, for example, and if it brings its own autoplot implementation, we can just call autoplot on it and it will show us a bunch of things usually at the same time. I'm not going to talk about what's displayed here. Some of these things you have seen before, like quantile plots, for example. But autoplots exist for a bunch of things. And because they are normal ggplots objects, we can now use other ggplot functions with it. For example, we can turn this into, like, use a different theme with it, for example. Because it's just a regular ggplot object. So this is often a good way to get started. But I also want to use this as a way of talking about when and how you should use these automatic plots. Any plot that comes from, like, autoplot, for example, or is automatically generated with something like ggpubr or ggsignif. These are often great ways of exploring your data and getting a very quick overview of what you're dealing with. But they are not designed to be, like, often not designed to communicate directly to, like, a reader of your plot. There's two different phases in when you're making plots. And the first one is you're making plots for yourself. You want to understand your data, you want to generate insights. And now the second plot, and I think this is often overlooked, especially in research communication and papers. Often people then just take the plots they made for themselves and put them in the paper. But these plots were never designed to communicate with readers directly. So when you have gone through your plots, when you made your plots, when you explored your data, you know so much about your data that the reader probably doesn't know. You need to then go the extra mile to design plots that are designed to communicate with a reader. And this can often not be done with some automatic prepackaged function. This takes more work, but it's definitely worth it because more people will understand what you want to tell them. And this is something that is also incredibly hard to teach because it just takes a bunch of practice and work. So, just try to think about this when you're designing plots for other people to read. Do so with intent. Think about what you want to show them, how you want to show it. Experiment with different ways. This is why I'm teaching you ggplot, because it allows you to experiment very quickly with different ways of showing your data. And oh, this is actually a good segue to the next package I want to show you, which I, for myself, haven't actually actively used, and I will explain so why in a second, but why you might still use it and quite like it. It's called Esquiz. I'm not sure if I have installed it. It's also on the ggplot extensions page. And once you have installed it, you should get an RStudio add-in that is called Esquiz. No, it's not here. Oh, ggplot builder, yeah. Okay, I can also call it with my command palette in RStudio. Esquiz ggplot builder, yeah. It does require additional packages. Let's install those, should be fine. All right, now it's starting. It wants us to select a data frame from the global environment. We can then import our data. And now we can graphically, with our mouse, create a plot. Say we want to have the build length on the x-axis and the build depth on the y-axis, and the species as the color, Maybe we want to facet by island. So you see already, actually this is quite nice. I'm sometimes faster when I'm just typing, but this is actually really nice. We can change the appearance here. You can use specific colors. Oh my, this is really cool. It also improved a lot since the last time they made it. So we can interactively create our plot here. This color is a bit too light. Let's make it a different one. You can change a bunch of things, or you can even change the legend position. You can use more plot options. And all these things are also available just from code from ggplot. Oh, there's some pre-built defaults, if the data allows for it. This probably doesn't make any sense here. Points would be better here. And now in the end, I believe, yeah, we can save the plot, which is nice. But what I always recommend you to do is don't just save the plot from here. Always save the code instead. So you go up here and this generated the code for you. So we insert in the code and that should be it. Yes. And now, oh, this should actually be in a code chunk. So let's make sure it's in a code chunk. And we don't need to load ggplot anymore because we have already loaded the tidyverse. So now we are back to the plot we had earlier on, created with squeeze. And we can use it. And the reason, of course, I want you to save the code is that if you have your code and your raw data, you can always recreate your plots. If you just have your plots, it's not as easy. So make sure to always save your code, your recipe for creating your end product. And this will also make it easier if you get new data, you have to do it again, for example. You don't have to click through it every time. And this is like the great advantage of having a coding language here. All right, this is actually very handy. And then if you have your plot and you want to do more advanced stuff, you can still do so. Anything that is possible with ggplot, you can do. That is maybe not possible inside of this graphical editor that they provide. All right, this was very cool. Another cool extension I want to show you is GG Animate. And for this, let's actually stay with penguins, I guess. Oh, let's steal a plot here. Well, it's not stealing if we made it, right? Say we wanted to, instead of color coding the species by color, we want to use a dimension we haven't used before, and this is time. We want to animate this whole thing, and this is where GG Animate comes in. GG Animate, if we load it, brings us another thing. Oh, it noticed, I need the GIFSKI package. Let's do this. Right, now that we have installed the GIFSKI package as well, let's run this. All right, it works now. So we should have able, sometimes when I can't remember the name of a function, I just look at the package functions. I believe they all start with transition. Yeah, all right. So when we already have a variable that represents a time, we can use something like transition time, but right now we don't have something like time. Let's do this as transition states. And I want to have these species be different states of our animation. Let's see if this works. And yeah, now we just what ggplot did is just created individual. Oh no, I created them in the folder here. That's not good. Let's delete these. So these are the individual frames of our animation. Let's delete these. I believe the reason is it told me that I need to restart my R session after I installed the GIFSKY package. And I didn't do that. So I have now restarted my R session and rerun the code, and now we can go here. It is now rendering. That's good. And oh yeah, there we go. Okay, this is actually quite boring. Now it's just three different states that are cycling around in this GIF. All right, and I just realized this is probably not the best data to show with an animation because we don't have any real way of interpolating between the data points. I mean, if every point is a different penguin, and there wouldn't be any case for like moving points around smoothly and transforming them into each other because of all the penguins didn't transform into penguins of other species. So let's recreate a classical example from the Gapminder package. And let's see how I can reproduce this from memory because I've done this before. So I want to plot the I want to plot the GDP per capita and the life expectancy. Let's make the size the population. All right. And now we have multiple data points for each multiple data points, of course, for each country. Let's deal with this in a second. I want to scale the x-axis logarithmically. I think that makes sense. And yeah, see these big points? This is, I best believe, China on all the different years. What we could do is facet wrap by year. And let's also make the color depend on the country. And oh, I'm plotting the legend again. That's not helpful. I want to scale the color manually, where the values are the Gapminder country colors. And I also want to hide the color legend. All right. And now imagine, actually, let's also hide the size for now. And now imagine we take this into sort of like a flipbook thing and turn each year into a frame in an animation or multiple frames, and we can even interpolate between those frames. So instead of facet wrapping by year, I want to transition time, where the time is the year. If you look at the website for the package, it shows you also more options that you can use to control the length of the animation. And there we have it. We have our animation. In just one additional line of code, we animated the time. And we can see countries bobbing around. And the final package I want to show you today is the Shiny package. Once again, you can install it the regular way using install packages. Install packages, shiny, but of course I have already done so. And then you might have to restart RStudio, because then you can use this template up here. After having restarted RStudio, you can create a shiny web app. So shiny is an R package to create interactive applications that run R code. So let's call it example app in this folder here, yes. And I'm going to create a single file app. It's just called app.r. And whenever you have a file which just somehow contains the word shiny in a comment, RStudio will display the run app button up here. But we can also just run or source the whole script, which will do the same thing, because in the end it runs the app. And let me open this up on the side. It runs the app now. So we can have a look. Let me make this bigger to see what's happening. What we have here. So we have a plot. It's a histogram of some example data that is built into R. And we have a slider to control the number of bins. So whenever we change this, R will notice that the value changed and rerun the R code that generates this plot. So let's see how we can make changes to this example app. There's two parts to every app. There's a user interface, which is what you see, and there's the server, which serves the interface things to display and executes code to run. So in let's start with things we can see. We can change the title here. Let's go with penguins again. So for this, outside of the UI and server, I also want to load the Palmer Penguins package. I also want to load the tidyverse. Alright, so if we run this again, not much should have changed. The only thing that's changed is the title here, which if we open this up in a web browser, will also be the title of this page here, penguins. Yeah, there we go. All right. And now there's a couple of layout things. So the main thing here is this whole user interface is designed by this fluid page function, and all the components that are going onto our page go into this fluid page function, all separated by a commata. And so we've got a title panel, and then we have this sidebar layout thing, which consists of a sidebar panel and a main panel. So in this main panel, we have the plot. In the sidebar, we have the controls for our plot. So let's do our own thing. Let's delete this slider input for now. And also, let's delete the plot. Now it will complain because we haven't closed the sidebar panel here. And we need to separate it with the comma. And in the output, let's delete all this stuff. Let's give it a better name. Let's call it main plot. So if I run this, this shouldn't do anything. All right, we just got an empty sidebar and an empty main plot. So in our main panel, let's put a plot there. So in the main panel, I want a plot output. So all these things, they end up with the capital O output. And if you check out the shiny documentation, which I will link to in the script, you will see all the different types of outputs there are. Let me quickly open this up because the documentation is pretty good. Shiny R, maybe. Yes. And one slight note, if you're Googling for something or DuckDuckGoing for some help on an R package, sometimes, because R is just very short, You might need to use the full name like rstats to find packages. But in this case, we are finding better results using just our shiny r package. So, usually works. And what I also often do is also search for GitHub, because this leads us straight to where the developers put the source code for this package. And this is usually also where they have a link to the website, if you're not finding it straight away. So I almost always search for the GitHub page for the particular package. And this is common for all the modern packages. They have GitHub pages. And then you can, of course, even look through the source code for the package if you so desire. All right, Shiny, this is the website. There's a bunch of examples you can draw from, all with code available. And there's this reference section, which lists all the functions. So if I search for output here, we get all the outputs that we can have. And in this case, we're just using a plot output. Right, plot output. Plot output needs to get an output ID. Let's call it main plot. And that's about it. We can also set more things like the width and the height, as seen in the help page here. But this should be enough. If I run this now, I'm expecting to get an error or no output at all, because we are not passing anything to this output. We have just defined that in the main panel, there's going to be an output called main plot. And this relates to the server function, where we have our output list, and anything we put into this main plot will then be displayed in the plot output. And plot output just expects something that was created with the function render plot. So plots or outputs usually expect something that was created by one of these render functions. There's more of these: render text, for example, render image, or render plot, or even render table. And there's more packages that give you more render functions as well. Now let's create a plot in here. Oh, I should pass the penguins. And let's look at the penguins here in our little console. Now this is of course different. This is a regular R script, not R Markdown, so we are getting the output here in our console. Let's plot the build lengths versus the flipper lengths. Let's run this. And there we have our plot. Now, right now, nothing here is interactive. So in our sidebar panel, well, we could of course add them in other places, but it makes sense to have them in the sidebar. Let's add some inputs. Oh, this is so all the inputs, if I would probably have to pull up the Shiny documentation again to show you. All the input functions, they end up with like a capital input. So, oh, there's already the inputs, and there's a bunch of different inputs we can choose from. Let's go with a select input for now. Select input. Let's close this. Normally, I would have this on the side while I'm working. So first argument is the input ID and then the label. Let's say we want to have a selector for the species. So the ID is species and the label is a capital species. If I run this, it doesn't work because the select input also wants to have some choices. So choices would be Is it the third argument? Yes. Choices would be something that you can select. So I do it like this. You can select first or second. And let me actually just show you what's happening in the server, on the server side. Let's create a. Let's do it in the sidebar as well. So separate it with a comma and add a text output. Let's call it debug because we're debugging things. And in the main, the server function, I want to pass something to the output debug. I use render text here. Render text just takes an expression. We can make sure we can use multi-line expressions by using curly braces. Same as in render plot, it's usually curly braces around these. And I just want to show input at the position species. So all the inputs end up in this input list. And now we are passing this input to our output, essentially. So now we have this text, which t tells us what is currently selected. Let's do something with this text. Firstly, I want this to be able to select species. So we could now manually write down all these species, but I'm lazy. So we are going to go into the penguins species. And this is, of course, the raw vector of all these species. And I'm going to use the function unique, which gives us just the three unique values we can have for species. Add large n2 and chinstrap. And I believe I deleted some comma by accident. All right, fixed the formatting. Now we can select our species. And let's use this the selected species in our plot here by filtering by species. So filter species equals equals input species. And now what should happen is as we change this, okay, we get an error. Let's see what's happening here. We forgot the pipe here, so we didn't pass anything useful to ggplot. As we change this, the data in the plot changes. And let's make this a bit more obvious than with our debug thing. Let's add a label where the title is. I think I'd like to use the clue package for this. Where the title is. Data shown for species. And in here we put input species. All right, and now we have a yes. We have a title, and it changes as we go along. While we're at it, let's also. I'm kind of in a flow right now, so let's keep going. Let's also add a table. Table output. Call it main table. And now in the output, we are creating a main table. We are assigning to this main table in the output. We need render table here. Table takes an expression, and whatever is happening at the end of this expression will be displayed in the table. So it's just this part. And here's the complete data set that is being displayed up top. Now this just displays the complete table. What if we want a cooler table like the one we have in our Markdown files, where we have this page tables? I believe for this we need the DT package, capital D, capital T, which stands for data table. And then we can use DT render data table, okay. So let's do it like this. And this one, data is data table output, okay. Let's see if this works. All right, that's actually nice. It also has the search functionality, so we can search for the different islands, for example, that we have. Oh, it's all on one island. Well, this is quite handy. And while we're at it, let me mention another concept that might be helpful for your data analysis work. And this is a point I want to really stress. All our data analysis and our like app building and making plots, it's an iterative process. The code you are seeing on the website, it's not the way I wrote it when I first designed the lecture. Like I went over it again, I revised it. Nobody writes perfect code on first try. The first code you write will probably not work, it will throw errors, and then you get it to work. And this is where lots of people stop. Don't do that. Once the code works, you need to also make sure it works correctly. And then if you made sure that it not only works, but also works correctly, you can then go the extra mile and make it more elegant. This can sometimes feel like a waste of time, especially for code you only need once. It is fairly obvious that if it's code you are going to need in the future, you want to clean up more. But even for code you only write once, if you have some time at your hands, go about just cleaning the code up a bit. Sometimes we call this refactoring, when we are moving pieces of code around to be more logical and safer. Yeah, also take the time for data analysis projects to refine your code, because you will be learning so much in the process that the next time you're writing code, it will be more elegant from the get-go. It will be easier to understand for future you and for other people looking at your code. This can also sometimes be frustrating, because it means you are constantly getting better at coding. So because you're looking at your older code, your older code will always look terrible. Because you have learned so much in the time in between. But this is, of course, a good thing, right? If you look at your older code and you see that it's terrible, it means you learned a bunch. So in the spirit of cleaning code up and refactoring, let's notice that we have this data set, which is filtered down. And we're doing this twice. If we are building this up into like a bigger application, we probably want this filtered data set in multiple places. And we want it to be the same, and we don't want to do the operation again and again. And for this, let me introduce the concept of a reactive expression. So we have this reactive thing. It wraps a normal expression to create a reactive expression. Conceptually, a reactive expression is an expression whose result will change over time. And it will change depending on the inputs that change. So we're creating a reactive expression, and we want to make this thing here a reactive expression. Let's give this a name. Let's call it filtered penguins. And it also warns us we defined it, but we are not using it. And in here we now want to use the filtered penguins. There's one confusing thing. We can now no longer use this as a normal data frame. Let me quickly show you. If I put this in the places we previously had it. It says, error, you're passing a function as global data, or data must be two-dimensional. So those come down to the same error that's happening. And this is reactive returns a function. Here we go. So filtered penguins is actually no longer the data set. It is a function that when being called, and this is what we have to do here, we call the filtered penguins function, will give us the current state of the filtered penguins data set. And this will then look up in the input vector and see if it changed. And if it changed, it will, so if the input vector changed, it will notify all reactive expressions that depend on it and update the data set accordingly. So now same output as before, but we have gone about cleaning our code up a bit and we can reuse it. Let me add another thing that you might want to do, and to justify just having this reactive expression here, we might want a download button. I think that's a download button. But I believe download button goes into the UI. We need like a download handler down here. Let's look at the example. It's a download handler. I just copy and paste this example. So the download handler needs to have a function file name. All right, looking good. And it needs to have the data to write. So the file is what it's being written to. And here the data, instead, we are going to pass the filtered penguins. And now we need to actually create the download button in our panel here. It has an ID. We called it download button. Let's run this and see if it works without us having to do extra work. And oh boy, yeah, looking good. We have the download button. Let's see if it does something. We can click on it, download our data in CSV format. And I believe it worked. Let me quickly check this by running read lines. And I'm going to do it to my desktop, data CSV. All right, there we have it. We built a download button for our app. Now let's talk about publishing this app. And this is the disadvantage of Shiny apps as opposed to R Markdown documents. When you render your R Markdown document, you can send this HTML file to whoever wants it, and they can read it just using a normal web browser. Same as if you are writing to like a PDF output, for example, or you're rendering your Markdown document to a Word document. But for a Shiny app to run, you need to actually run R. And there are ways of packaging this, but the easiest way to go is publishing applications using shinyapps.io. And this means your app will be hosted online somewhere and you can send people a link. I need to install some additional packages for this. But what this will do is it uploads your application to a server, and a server is just some computer somewhere else. And this computer will then run your application and you can send people to it using a link. Or what you can also do is set up your own server if you so desire, which is actually not that hard. Let's publish this and see how it goes, actually. That's going to be interesting to see. Let me have another sip of water. So yeah, what it also needs to do is, of course, is install all the packages that the app needs on the server. So depending on how large your application is, this may take a while. While this is happening, let me talk about the exercises. So for the exercises, these are a bit more freestyle this time. Because well, it's your last chance to experiment with your data analysis and get some detailed feedback on your analysis. So what I want you to do is go to the Tidy Tuesday website or Tidy Tuesday GitHub repository, and on the datasets section, you can see all the old datasets from 2018 to this year. There is a new dataset coming out every Tuesday with some very interesting topics. So what I'd like you to do is you pick whatever dataset interests you the most and write an analysis. Write in just once again in a new R Markdown document. You're writing this report and really focus on making some cool plots. Let's talk about this first. Really focus on exploring the data, but then also making some cool plots. Make sure you take your time and really refine one or two of these plots in addition to your exploratory plots. And then I will first show you the seminar. So it's now hosted on shinyapps.io. If I send people this link, they can go there and explore the data set. So we have just basically built an interactive website that is hosted on shinyapps.io. About the exercises, have fun doing so. That's the most important part. And then I will see you in the seminar. One last thing, I will also send out a link with a feedback form, which is anonymous, so you can write anything you like in there. And then I will see you in the seminar.